Ruby Rose, Bryce Snead, Blake Belladonna, and Yang Xiaolong.
Otherwise known as Team Ruby.
While it's true that as a team they are absolutely amazing, and of them, which is the strongest?
He's not Wiz and I'm not Boomstick.
It's our job to analyze their weapons, armor, and skills, find out who would win a not-death battle. Before we get into it, let's establish a few rules. Firstly, this is strictly a pre-timeskip fight. Using post-timeskip requires a lot of assumptions, not to mention that their abilities aren't at their best, yet that's a little annoying for us.
Secondly, we won't be allowing Ruby Silver Eyes as we don't know the true extent of their power, and we will be giving Yang both arms, so it's Yang at her best.
Finally, this fight would never actually happen in canon, so just keep that in mind before you go APE SHIT over it.
No, but now, let's get onto the actual analysis.
Summer of Rose was a supermom, slayer of monsters, baker of cookies, and leader of Team Stark.
Ha! Like Stark White.
Yes, you fucking genius.
Why, thank you!
Anyway, Summer Rose met Taiyang Xiaolong. The two meet a whoopee.
What the hell is whoopee?
Can you stop interrupting me?
Seriously, this shit is whoopee.
You know, when you make love with children and stuff.
Oh, you mean fucking.
A Boomstick, have some class.
Why are we satirizing an underrated viewer's Skewniverse movie?
Just shut the fuck up.
When did I ever have class?
Okay, so after that, two, you know, as Not Boomstick puts it, fucked, they had a child. One that would grow up into a powerful, fast, and justice-loving fighter.
And this child was named Ruby Rose.
Not the real-life person. Ruby Rose is the leader of Beacon Team Ruby, and was taken in 2 years before she had even finished her previous academy years. In the process, Ruby Rose's growth increased faster, and she soon became a skilled and respected huntress in training.
Ruby Rose is no pushover. She's strong enough to kick a full-grown man out of a building, and tough enough to tank a direct shot from Melodic Kujil and recover in moments.
That's Roman's Kane.
To put that into perspective, Melodic Kujil can blow holes into solid concrete.
It's belonged by Roman. But beyond strength and durability, Ruby Rose's best ability is her incredible speed. Ruby Rose's semblance speed, as the name would suggest, is a speed-enhancing ability. Semblances are tangible forms of one's aura. A natural protective and enhancing field created from one's own soul. Yes, I said semblant.
Thanks for the school lesson, especially because we already explained it in episode 20.
Shut up. Ruby's semblance increases her speed dramatically. She's fast enough to dodge machine gun fire and move in what appears to be like a blur. However, her best feat of speed is this OP whirlwind thing, in which she literally blazes through a building fast enough to carry the tables, fuck you, food, and counteract the semblance of Piranikos. Who can do this?
To accomplish this, she must have had to move at a wind speed nearing that of an F2 tornado, giving her a speed of 302 miles per hour, or 135 meters per second. Jesus Christ! Not to mention she was against her friends, so she was lightly holding back. Although this being an outlier is only having happened once, take this with a pinch of salt.
To put that into perspective, an F2 tornado can rip roofs off houses, snap trees in half, and lift up cars.
Yeah. But if she spent 16 seconds running at 135 meters per second, then that means the building was 2.16 kilometers long.
But we only saw 9 seconds of her actually moving.
So, 1.21 kilometers long.
Sir, when did you get smart?
Since always. I have an IQ of 256.
But my IQ is only 350. Fuck yeah, squirrels.
P.S. I killed Johnson the IQ squirrel.
Yeah.
JK!
Okay, well anyway, Ruby doesn't even need a semblance to be able to run up a wall, yet that can also be enhanced by her weapon.
Oh yeah, one of the best things in Ruby. Ruby wields a 7'2" or 2.2 meter tall scythe, known as Crescent Rose.
It's also a gun.
Yeah, that. Crescent Rose is a high caliber sniper scythe, and has three modes. A boring ass storage mode, a giant ass gun looks like a bunch of fridge stuck together with a handle, and a badass scythe.
Crescent Rose's gun is powerful enough to blow the head right off a lesser bear roof, and his scythe is sharp enough to effortlessly cut through a tree with a lackluster swing.
The scythe is a gun powerful enough to propel her up a building with one shot, and this power can be used to increase the swing power. Also like a pogo stick, she can do this. Yay! Oh, and it can decapitate into a giant bird monster thing.
However, despite this, it still lacks strength in both projectile and cutting power. Against more armored foes, Ruby also may be a little too reliant on it.
But damn is she good at what she does. She can kill an entire horde of Krim as if it was nothing, and without getting hit once, unlike literally every other Ruby member during their trailers. She can jump so high and fast she didn't even look like she moved, and do an epic tornado spinning thing so fast Grim never even saw her coming.
She's also quite a competent strategist, and whether it's that skill or just dumb luck, Ruby has the best win-loss record amongst Team Ruby, with literally no losses in the entire first three volumes, with only 4 draws and 1 flee.
How? How? She's literally only 15 years old!
Mary Sue, and that brings us to her weaknesses. Ruby is, well, kinda stupid.
My semblance is polarity.
Oh, you can control poles.
No, you dunce!
Yeah, that. Not just there, but also when she stands there with a red dust crystal thrown at her, then shot right in front of her!
And then not using her semblance to get away from 2 giant Grim chasing her! This happens again in No Breaks.
And not using her semblance against these grunts. Speaking of which, without a crescent rose, she really lacks any kind of hand-to-hand combat and can be defeated by simple white fang grunts. Again. She also lacks an accuracy unless completely still and using her scythe like a monopad. That is, unless it's in gun mode.
Also, she's pretty damn predictable. With not only Mercury Black, but also a fucking Grim being able to predict her straightforward fighting style of charge in and fuck shit up. This also moves on her semblance being unable to do much beyond moving into a straight line until Volume 4.
This is all so where it must be noted that she can't carry heavy things.
Like my dick! Yet, it doesn't exactly hinder her too much. She can still fight for days on end, take down a team in one attack, skate on tables with a food tray, and even take on Neo and Roman simultaneously, despite being on the losing streak during the entire fight. She won.
Oh, and she beat Carden, but who gives a shit?
Dude, Carden is like the one character being who's been beaten one-on-one by a Mech Grim.
Good point.
But back on track, Ruby is one not to be messed with. She's tough as hell, fast as shit, and powerful as all fuck. Don't screw with Ruby Rose.
I only have 2 more years of training left at Signal, and then I'm going to apply to Beacon. See, my sister's starting there this year, and she's trying to become a Huntress, and I'm trying to become a Huntress because I want to help people. My parents always taught us to help others, so I thought, oh, I might as well make a career out of it. I mean, the police are alright, but Huntsmen and Huntresses are just so much more romantic and exciting and cool, just, you know?
The world of Remnant isn't powered by electricity, gas, oil, or coal, but by dust.
And the head of that industry is the Schnee Dust Company.
Including the such stellar people as the prick Jack Snee, the creeper Whitley Snee, and the strict cold and kinda hot Winter Snee.
But screw all of them, especially Winter. Today we are talking about the youngest daughter, Weiss Snee.
The most proficient wielder of dust amongst Team Ruby. Why sneeze the proud hairness to the Snee Dust Company? Whoa, yay.
And point of the show! Weiss's weapon is literally called the Multi-Dust Action Rapier Mietzenmaster.
This rapier can use multiple types of dust for multiple effects. Red dust can shoot fire and create shields capable of blocking attacks from this thing.
Blue dust can fire ice, freeze a Death Stalker in place, freeze a giant Nevermore in place, create ice stones KO protecting the move from the impact of the train colliding into the wall and exploding, although it did break that last time.
Well, rip. Green dust can disarm foes.
And finally, white dust can perform a massive stamina attack capable of killing this thing.
Custom made possession type Grim.
Okay.
Even without dust, the rapier can create shields capable of blocking the white thing lieutenant, which is cool.
What about Weiss herself, though? Well, she's fast as shit. She can zoom across an entire battlefield and block an attack before said attack can even land.
And she can survive a small dust explosion without damage to her clothes.
Oh, screw her clothes! What about her semblance?
What?
Her semblance! You know the glyphs?
Oh yeah, sure. Weiss's semblance is the creation of glyphs and easily one of the most versatile amongst Ruby's semblances.
While not official, we can assume the effects of each of her glyphs.
White glyphs can be used as platforms and light-pushing devices.
Black glyphs can suck things towards them.
Like my and then red glyphs can fire them away violently.
Yellow glyphs can increase one's speed to the point of ad-speeding missiles.
Explosive LGBT glyphs cause explosions.
LGBT?
You know, because it's all for the rainbow.
Too far.
What?
She has 2 laser glyphs, one that traps and one that explodes. She can use her white glyphs as platforms and zip around like a blur using them.
She can also use them to do some quick blurring attacks.
She can also use them for cryokinesis, making giant hands, boulders, and slides out of ice, seemingly from nowhere.
She can smack a group of people away and throw herself several miles into the air.
But then there's her magnum opus, the Suman.
summoned. Now, we may be going a bit far allowing this, but deal with it!
Rich!
If Weiss's extreme anger is about to be smacked really hard, she can summon the arm and sword of the giant Armonite capable of slicing giant mechs in half, but it leaves her exhausted.
Exhausted or not, she's skilled enough to hold her own against the highly skilled and ranking Allied Fang Lieutenant, defeat the White Armor Knight, and take down a Borbatov.
Which is edgy, Sonic. She can also smack someone across the room with a swordfish.
Great contribution.
Thanks, buddy. She can freeze the entire ground of a whole highway in a random area, blaze through a group of douchebags, swing ice swords around, and do this wicked slasher combo.
She also was the only one other than that seemingly Mary Sue Ruby to not take any terrible damage during the fall of Beacon.
But she has one crippling weakness, her lacking durability. One punch from the giant armor broke straight through her aura and caused the only blood in the first two volumes to appear. She was the only one exhausted of the giant Nevermore fight, and was even exhausted running from Beowulfs. She was knocked out by Nora, the White Fang Lieutenant, and even by herself in Nevermore's debate. Heck, while she lost her own aura, the other guy just walked up. Fun. Mate.
She can also leave herself wide open sometimes, and has basically no strength feats. Oh, and she's a good singer.
What the fuck does that have to do with anything?
Absolutely nothing.
Then why?
Because this segment's over and I wanted to mention it.
Oh, okay. Wait, what?
So, why choose this over a cushy job in Atlas?
It's exactly as you said. I'm a Schnee. I have a legacy of honor to uphold.
The Faunus, a group of human-animal hybrids shunned by most of society.
Like African-Americans in the bad old days of the US of A?
You're Australian. Why talk about it like you were down there?
Oh, fuck the upshot!
But from racism, we mean no offense, we are so sorry, the White Fang was born. A group of Faunus right activists who performed peaceful protests. That's fucking boring.
And little Blake Belladonna was daughter of their leader.
That was until the old leader stepped down and the new one, Sienna Khan, came in.
Then Blake went all angsty with her boyfriend, mentor, master, whatever, Adam, Taurus, became evilly. And, you know, Blake did the first thing she could think of. She sat down, talked it out, and acting like a responsible she just ran away.
So she went to Beacon as a silent, hidden Faunus.
So what can she do? Well, she's strong enough to effortlessly smack Nora Valkyrie away, which is a string of sausages, and swing Yang around effortlessly.
She's fast enough to run across the Nevermore in seconds, run up walls, run up and jump across buildings, and then cars too.
She can survive an explosion right by her feet.
That is if you can hit her. Blake's semblance is known as Shadow, and allows her to create empty clones of herself to be used as platforms and shields.
She can jump around and use these in mere seconds to avoid incoming attacks, and help recover from a long-ass fall.
She can also dodge and block machine gun fire from ease in case you think ranged helps.
She can also enhance her semblance with dust.
Fire dust causes explosions, stone dust creates tougher and longer lasting decoys, and ice dust can be used to trap and shore the weapons of others.
She can also channel or enter a weapon to fire out a purple pulse of energy.
Speaking of which, her variant ballistic chain scythe Gremble Shoud is one of the most ridiculous weapons we've ever seen.
The weapon is a katana, kusarigama, gun, grappling hook, cleaver, and when unsheathed, the sheath itself can be used as a weapon.
It can cut through solid metal and even missiles, and the ribbon fin is strong enough to stay intact while Blake swings the white in a wide arc.
The gun itself is strong enough to repel the gun this far a distance and stab into solid concrete.
And Blake can use the ribbon to pull the trigger form a distance to even shoot from behind and swing around in a spear of blades.
Blake is pretty skilled too, being the only member of Team Ruby to survive outside the kingdoms as a young child. Then not only ignore going to previous training school, but also entering Beacon without knowledge from said school. She even gets up with her teammates and even the world-renowned fighter Pyrrho Nikos, who was able to take on a Fall Maiden with skill alone.
She matched Roman Torchwick, who later took on both her and Sun Wukong at the same time, then later defeated him in the biggest curb stomp battles in the whole series.
She is smart enough to set up traps and tricks on her opponents, and has taken out a mass of robots with Adam Taurus. Her Faunus heritage also grants her both enhanced hearing and night vision.
Best for whore, yes, Blake is a whore, she lacks any real weaknesses. She may be a coward at the core and may be the most well-rounded fighter, but the least specialized member of her team. But that really isn't too bad. Although she did still get her ass kicked from Adam.
But hey, she's a ninja too! And despite her few issues, she's the most well-rounded, as we said before, and skilled amongst Team Ruby. I don't want to fight with this kitty cat at all.
Nice night, don't you think?
Yes. It's lovely. Almost as lovely as this book.
that I will continue to read. As soon as you leave.
Yes, Yang has been here before. This analysis will most likely be a recap, and we won't go into much detail. Watch the Yang vs. Hulk battle for more in-depth info, aka, self-promotion.
The sister of Ruby Rose, Yang Xiaolong is the child of Tai Yang Xiaolong, and the worst mother of all time.
Yang is powerful as old fuck, but not as much as the Hulk.
Yang is strong enough to punch a grown man several meters away without any use of her semblance or weapons. She can shake the ground, cause a ripple and an explosion with one punch, knock an Osai around like it was nothing, and then punch it through several trees, punch and kick watermelons to pieces, and throw tokens from her fist with nothing but her punching string.
She punched Lai Ren into the ground so hard he created a shockwave that knocked tables away, pulled around a giant speaker so heavy it shook the ground when placed down, and smacked and punched the crowd across an entire street.
She's fast enough to dodge machine gun fire, which doesn't seem too cool now, but also dodge a missile. She also kicked up with Mercury Black, who can tag Ruby Rose and now run Gatling gun fire.
She's tough enough to take getting smacked across a nightclub, getting knocked into a sky so high that she landed at terminal velocity with ease, and being hammered through four solid concrete pillars at high speed before getting punched through another.
She has been slammed to the ground by three Nevermores from quite high up, and continued fighting moments later. And she survived this barrage of
When, motherfucker, do you fucking speak it? I'm fucking done, ooh. She also wields the Ember Celica, a pair of dual-range shock gauntlets, two gauntlets with shotguns built in.
These gauntlets fire up balls of kinetic energy and dust that explode, with both explosive and normal dust rounds. She can also fly with them too.
What? These blasts can knock people around, create some kind of propulsion, and blast people several meters back.
And she's got some gauntlet pyrokinesis. Yeah, it's subtle, but she can ignite her attacks with fire to the point of throwing a giant flaming uppercut and causing a massive explosion when angered.
With these abilities, she defeated the Malachi twins in a 2-on-1 fight, then Yang Xiong, Junior, by the way. Oh, and she took down Lai Wen like it was nothing.
These can be attributed to her semblance, however. It absorbs the energy of whatever hits her to increase her own physical strength. It has not affected durability, but it also has no defined limit. After a few hits, she could block and shatter both the arm and the entirety of the Allegiant Paladin.
She can leap several feet into the air with ease, defeated Militar Malachi almost immediately during her battle with the Malachi twins, took down an entire nightclub as if it was nothing, and punched a fully grown man, that being Junior, out of the building.
However, she's certainly not perfect. She lacks skill against opponents specializing kicks, and isn't particularly good against Super Gaiji characters.
She's also very easy to anger, being a double-edged sword. It can make her stronger and more ferocious, but she can become more predictable and easier to defeat.
But with all that in mind, Yang is one hot-as-fuck badass fighter who I wouldn't fuck with any day. Unless that was literal.
I can't take it anymore! Could everyone just chill out for 2 seconds before something crazy happens again?
Alright, weapons are ready and the commands are set. Let's end this actual debate once and for all.
It's time for Battle Sonic Battle! Bitch!
Kill each other!
Don't lose your way. Goodbye, please.
That was brutal.
If any of you say this result was obvious, I'll rip your fucking heads off. This debate is not that simple and not at all easy to solve.
Right, all the fighters could have won. It just happens that Yang would win most of the time, without a doubt. This is definitely one of our closest matchups.
Let's go over the fighters one by one.
Weiss is the first to go. While she easily holds her own through dust and versatility alone, that's mostly all she has. In speed, compared to Ruby, she's lesser, and against one like Yang, she lacks anything strong enough to actually kill her.
And Blake Summons can easily counter any glyphs Y might have. But if you're thinking Weiss is summoned, this is actually not as good as it seems.
After some hard analysis of the scene, we figured out why the Sword of the Armor Knight did more than anything else. Simply put, all the weapons we see being used on the Atlesian Paladins are ranged weapons. The only things that do any damage were Velvet Scarlatina and Weiss's Summon. It's not good to assume that Velvet's copies are more powerful than the real weapons, and one can easily see that when Velvet used ranged attacks, that they did a lot less damage than her melee ones. One can even observe this in an unfinished version that was fought earlier, especially when Neptune Basilius attacks, which did no damage from range, but his Gudau and Trident seemed perfectly capable of piercing it. They even defeated it mostly through melee attacks.
And with Yang's strength as it is, it's no wonder that she could overpower the giant armor. One punch in the armor threw Wei several meters away, yet one punch from Yang threw a Hei Shuang several meters away. The destruction of Weiss's aura doesn't help the armor either, as Weiss is certainly not that durable, especially when compared to Junior.
Of course the Knight isn't useless. It can still do damage if it hits, but it's not that helpful, especially considering Weiss defeated it before. While many characters have defeated Weiss in turn.
Don't forget that Weiss's lagging durability doesn't help her in a fight against someone faster, someone more skilled, and someone far stronger. All of which can take her out with just one good combo.
Moving on from Rice, Blake is certainly strong, don't get us wrong, but she doesn't have enough to kill the other two more than they can kill her. Blake can defeat Weiss, sure, but against Yang, while she might have the agility and dodging, maybe even skill advantage, she still has to outlast Yang. Unlike Neo, who had the luxury of a 1v1 battle, Blake has to take out all of her foes. Her simplest just can't win this against three people. Against Ruby, she has even less of a chance. The only character who can outspeed Blake's semblance is, in fact, Ruby.
And while Ruby is quite predictable, Blake still needs a way to deal with Ruby's speed, which for her isn't exactly easy. Blake hasn't shown any real speed fighting feats, as most of her fighting revolves around her semblance and not outspeeding others. So it's reasonable to assume she could not outspeed Ruby Rose.
And before you say faunus are better than humans physically, well...
EVIDENCE! Apart from hearing a sight, there are no bits of evidence to suggest this. They are basically just regular people with animal parts, guys. Dog!
And finally, Ruby vs. Yang is a really, really tough one. Really, really tough. Ruby has humongous speed advantage and range and agility.
While Yang has a skill, strength, and experience advantage, not to mention durability.
This is not a simple battle, but the greatest way to explain why Yang would win is to put it like this. Ruby is fast, yes. But if Mercury can predict their movements, then why wouldn't Yang, who, mind you, is her sister, be able to?
Yang only needs a few good hits to be able to be put into position to take Ruby down, but Ruby would need a hell of a lot of hits.
Ruby's also nowhere near as experienced, being younger, never finishing her training at Signal, and facing mostly Grimm in her experience.
And Yang most likely would have watched Ruby's training as it happened, making her chances of predicting Ruby all the more higher. Yang's durability means she'd easily be able to tank whatever is thrown at her by her teammates.
And that leads to one of her biggest advantages, Yang's semblance.
In a 1v1 fight, her semblance might take time to charge, but in a four-way battle and being hit from three different people in succession, Yang's semblance would build up in no time. Yang's power will grow continuously, and she's not likely to lose at that point.
With what we have there, there's your answer. But if we factor anything even post-time skip as well, there is no answer.
There will never be an answer.
A battle like this can go either way, and there will never be a definitive. I may have said that we finished the debate once and for all, but for the beauty of this fight, there may never be once and for all. Ruby will continue for quite some time in Volume 6, 8, or 49, 69, fucking sex, or whatever. There are things that will most likely change the fight. Ruby's eyes, Weiss's summons, Blake's experiences, and Yang's new arm will heavily contribute to a post-type skip fight.
So whether you think Ruby's speed, Weiss's fertility, Blake's agility, or Yang's strength will win, what matters isn't exactly whether you're right or wrong, but that it's your opinion and you made it yourself. If you can justify your opinions and who you think would win, that's all that matters. Who do you think Yang's snazzy strength, semblance, and durability would win?
But whether you think Ruby can take them bare before they know what happened,
or that Weiss can hit them with so many things they won't have time to enact,
or Blake can tire them out before going for the kill,
or you agree with us, what matters is that you have your opinion. Don't let the opinions of us drag you down. Tell us what you think in the comments. Don't get angry or war over things. Just share your opinions peacefully. Roots and Eve wouldn't want flame wars. Miles and Luna wouldn't want flame wars. And Monty Owen wouldn't want flame wars.
Exactly. Don't get angry that Yang won. Be happy that Rooster Teeth made the show, but the debate will continue for years later. And be happy that people like Screw Attack, Animation Rewind, and even us here at Nemesis Bladrock's channel here are, well, here to try and make you enjoy these battles and debates.
But in this battle, Yang couldn't have Ru being the loser.
The winner is Yang Xiaolong.
So what's the next time?
I don't know. I like how we ended that.
Yeah, let's not ruin it with a comedy segment.
I mean, we all know that Wise is the best waifu anyway, so no need to war.
Yeah, wait, what? No, Yang is best waifu.
No, Wise is.
Oh, you prissy little son of a bitch.
Better than your tiller-tailing temperamental edgelord.
Fuck you.
Fuck you back.
Didn't you talk about Yang being your darling and Yang vs. Hulk?
They're all my darlings and my darlings, I mean bitches. Wise is the best. Hey, Laurent. Yo. Tell me, who's the best waifu? It's obviously Yang. Fuck you, and you're supposed to be on my side. Jeez, chill, man.
Yeah, high five, little man!
Sure, but call me a little man again and I'll pale you on a chainsaw lightsaber thing.
Okay. So Nemesis! Ah, fuck you, what? Who is the best Ruby waifu? Yang, right, Neo? Fuck you! Fuck you back! Hey, Yuan, wanna make some Death Battle of Breeze style things?
Probably not, but yeah, sure.
Clearly, there's only one way to deal with this.
Aw, yeah, it's time!
It's time on Not Death Battle!
Bitch! Prepare for a penis paper cut.
Prepare for a shotgun face breaker.
Not Wiz versus Not Boomstick, hosted by Nemesis Bloodwreck and the Who Win. Wait, what?
Iron birds of fortune. I'll break above the sky. I'll be revelation. Seen by naked eyes. You find the tools of the-